All right. We are now going to go into the AJAX portion of our class, which is sort of the culmination of what we studied with client-side and server-side scripting. An important thing to realize is that AJAX is not a different programming language. There isn't the programming language of AJAX. AJAX is simply a particular way of using server-side and client-side scripting that is different than sort of what I would call the traditional way. The traditional way of web development involves a client making a request to a server and getting back a complete web page. All right. Now, that web page can contain some JavaScript that can provide a little bit of interactivity on the page, like a mouse over effect or something like that, or validation or whatever. So there is a possibility of having some scripting on the client side to tweak the page a little bit. But we're talking about generally the role of JavaScript is to modify an existing page. All right. So the server provides the data, and the JavaScript manipulates the existing page. Now, AJAX still keeps that model with one real important difference. And the real important difference is that we are not going to, or let me rephrase that. Some of the time, we're not going to get back a whole page. Some of the time, we're going to get back a piece of the page. We're going to get some data. All right? And in that way, we're sort of back to the old model of client-server, where the server was a repository of data. All right? And it simply gave the data to the client, then the client did whatever it wanted to with it. So that's exactly what we're going to do. Now, the best example I can think of to demonstrate what AJAX is the Google predictive search thing. So let's look at that for a second. And let's talk how we know this is AJAX. Even without me looking at the code, I can tell that it's AJAX. And let's look at it and determine why I can tell that it's AJAX. After we do this, I'll draw a little on the board to talk about how this differs from the old model, the traditional model. And then I hope I'll be able to find the example that I was looking for. And we'll be able to do that. If not, I'll come up with the new example. All right. So we go into Google. And notice, first of all, that when a page loads, let me hit refresh to reload the page. You're going to see something down here. You're going to see, maybe, you see the page sort of flicker. Let me go back to it. Notice resolving host, waiting for, blah, blah, blah. You see a dialogue going on there. It's telling you what it's doing. That's the process of it, of the browser requesting something from the server and getting back the web page. So we go to www.google.com. So we've requested a page from the Google web server. We get back this. Now, this is probably a server-side scripting page because, remember, you can customize your Google if you want to. I'm not logged in, but if I logged in, it would show my name at least, and I think you can further customize it if you want to. Now notice what happens as I start to type stuff in. I type in a P, it shows me the four things that are most popular that begin with a P. Pizza Hut, all right, I can buy that. Pink Moon, which I guess we're having this month, and I don't know what that means, but maybe we can look it up. Pinterest and Pandora. I type in a PH. Phone number search, Phillies, Photoshop, Phaedra Parks. All right. I type in a P, and it gives me three things that it thinks. PHP to US dollars. Apparently, that's probably the Philippine currency to US dollars. Then it shows me PHP, then PHP MyAdmin, and PHP dates. Apparently, doing dates in PHP is tricky, because that's one of the things, one of the choices. Now, it should be clear that something is going on beyond normal client server-side scripting. How I know the server is involved with this? I know the server is involved with this because apparently there's some database interactivity going through. All right? In other words, as I type in a letter, it shows me the four top searches for that combination of the letter. There's no way that the client would be able to determine that, right? There's no way we could put all the code and all the data from Google's databases that would tell me all of the words and allow me to do a search and do that on the client side. So clearly, I'm asking the server for that data, all right? Because this is sort of the heavy lifting that I'm talking about that the server provides, database interactivity. So clearly, this is connected to some sort of database, and the server is providing me the top four items with the particular combination of letters that I type in. So I know the server's involved. How do I know the client is involved? I know the client is involved because as I type in here, let's type something else in, Jay. Oh yeah, Jay Giles died, unfortunately. J-A-V-A. We get those things appearing, but those things appearing without an apparent reload of the page. In other words, when you reload the page, even if it's just briefly, you notice the entire page flickering. All right? We're on a very fast internet connection, which is normally good. I wish we were on a dial-up for this, all right? So I could demonstrate this a little better, how there's a little pause as the page refreshes, even for a small page like this, all right? It's refreshing very, very quickly. But here, when I type it in, the entire page is not flickering. I mean, if you look at the logo, if you look at the sign-in button, you don't see them blink or flicker. And you don't see anything down here on the status that indicates that things are being loaded from, you know, that it's reloading the page or whatever. So the client side, this is being done without the page reloading. And when interactivity happens on a page without the page reloading, that means that client side stuff is going on. All right? Because, you know, what are our other examples that we saw? Well, like on ESPN, as we put our mouse over these things, the page changes immediately without the page reloading. So we know that's client side. Same thing here. As I type, the page changes without the entire page reloading. So I know it's client side. So we know that it's server side is involved because the server side is supplying the data. It would be impossible for the client side to provide this data. There would just be too much data to be sent down to the client so that the client side could do this functionality. Because this works no matter what we type in, no matter what combination of letters we type in. I mean, Z, E, L, L. All right, it shows me the four most popular things. All right? So there's no way that all that data could come down to the client. So that has to live on the server. So the server has to be providing that data, and yet the client side is doing something with the data. We know that because the page is not flickering. It's not refreshing the entire page. Just that box is changing. Just the section of the page is changing. So that's a characteristic of AJAX. We're not going to change the entire page. We are going to refresh a portion of the page. Can anyone else think of some web applications that you use, some websites that you use that may be using AJAX, and why do you think they're using AJAX? Yes?
YouTube.
Why would you say that?
Because it has the exact same search.
Okay. YouTube has the exact same search functionality. So, yeah, absolutely. A lot of them that have this search, and YouTube is owned by Google, right? So that would make sense, right? that they would have that. What about Facebook?
Yeah.
All right, how is Facebook?
When you search for somebody in the top-ish, okay. You know, on the main page, it'll have a list of suggestions based on the characters.
Right. The same sort of search, I'm thinking of something else. If I am viewing someone's status, if someone posts a comment, I see the comment immediately without reloading the page, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. So that would be an example of AJAX. In other words, I didn't do anything. All right. I'm just sitting there looking at someone's status. And yet, the page doesn't completely reload, but if someone adds a comment, the code is smart enough to be looking for changes, and it will display the new comment. That's one example. Another example I just had on the tip of my top of my head, and I can't think of it. Gmail, right? Gmail is like that. It does have the predictive search, just like all of Google's products do. But the other thing that it does is if you're sitting there looking at your inbox and you get an email, that pops up. Right, you see it immediately, even if you don't hit refresh. All right, so those are all examples where the page gets data clearly that comes from a server, but the page is refreshed with that data without having to refresh the entire page. So, if we draw our traditional model, we have a client sitting here requesting a page through the internet, makes it to a server. Server runs a server-side script, maybe interacts with the database, and delivers back to the client an HTML page. So we need to get a little more precise here. This is a special kind of request. I think in previous examples I said the client makes a request. And that's a true statement. But to be more specific, the client makes an HTTP request or an HTTPS request. And you know that because if you look at the browser address bar, it says http://www.google.com. So that's the nature of the request. It's a specific kind of request. That request makes it to the web server, and the server responds with an HTML page. All right? And again, that request contains form data and all this other stuff that are used as ingredients to that server-side script. But the bottom line is that server-side script creates an HTML model. And even on sites that use AJAX, this is still used. For example, when you initially load your Gmail page, you know, your Gmail inbox, this would happen, right? You'd say, hey, I want to view my inbox. That'd be a request to the Gmail server, and Gmail would accumulate all the stuff in your inbox and send you back a web page that has it. Now, where does AJAX come in? AJAX comes in with this. There's a different kind of request, and there's a different kind of response. All right? So, this is, the kind of request this is an XML HTTP request. And this is a little bit slightly misnamed because you can use XML, but even if you don't use XML, you'll still make what's called an XML HTTP request. All right? But the point is, this is a different kind of request. And different kind of request gets a different kind of answer. All right? So, in the case of an HTML HTTP request that's made from within an existing web page, all right, that goes to the server, and the server responds, but the server responds with, instead of a complete HTML page, it responds with data. So, HTTP request goes and comes back with an HTML page. An XML HTTP request goes to the server likewise but the server responds with a block of data. Now that data might be an XML and maybe some of you have used XML in other courses. We'll talk about it later. But XML is simply a format that the data comes in. It could come into it could come in as what's called JSON data. It could come in as simply what's called a sequential data, delimited data. But it's not a complete web page. It is, however, used to update an existing web page. So let's talk about that Google example. We're at the client. We type in www.google.com. That goes to the server. We get back the Google search form. All right. So our initial request is an HTTP request, where we get back a web page. Now, what does a web page consist of? It consists of the HTML, but it also contains the JavaScript and CSS. And it contains the JavaScript to handle the making and processing of AJAX scripts. So that code that can handle AJAX requests is sent along with the initial web page. I now start typing the letters. So I type P. That makes a request, an HTTP request to the server, an XML HTTP request to the server. That gets routed to the server. The server does its thing, and it doesn't respond with the whole web page. It responds back with literally just those four words. Those four words that consist of the top four search terms. Now, I don't know the format it does. It might do it as XML, it might do it as delimited data or sequential data or whatever. But it somehow, it sends back those four words. And what happens with those four words? The JavaScript that was initially loaded with the page takes the results from that request, does whatever it wants to format them. In this case, it puts them in that little box up there that you could select. And the page changes, and the page is updated without reloading the page. So that's, in a nutshell, what happens in an AJAX request. Now, in an AJAX request, both the client side and the server side have roles. The server side kind of has an easier role than the client side. All right? There's a lot of work done on the client side, so a lot of work that happens in JavaScript. Let's look at sort of the breakdown of duties. JavaScript makes the XML HTTP request to the server. So as I type in the first letter, there's JavaScript code that says, hey, someone typed in a letter in that box. I need to run to the server and make a request. So the JavaScript makes that request to the server. The JavaScript then waits for an answer. Hopefully it doesn't wait too long, right? The whole purpose of AJAX would be defeated if it took a real long time for the server to respond to the request. Notice on Google's page, it's virtually immediate. I type in a letter, boom, I got my top four answers. All right? So JavaScript makes that request. It waits for an answer. What does the server do? The server processes the request. In other words, it looks to see, hey, what do we have here? We have a request for the top four search terms that start with the letter P. All right, let me do my thing. Let me look up in the database. And here we go. Here is the four. And it returns then to the client the data. And that data is not a complete web page. It's not even HTML code. Probably shouldn't be HTML code. I've seen people use AJAX where the server returns HTML. And that's kind of a limited way to do it. It's better if the server simply returns raw data, because that gives you more flexibility on how you're going to format it on the client side.
JavaScript then gets notified that the server is done. And JavaScript takes a response, that is the data that was sent by the server, and updates the page.
So, the server does pretty much everything that it always did, except the server's not even responsible for formatting it as HTML anymore, right? So if we remember our PHP scripts from previous classes, in our PHP scripts there were a lot of there was a lot of HTML code. In our AJAX PHP scripts, there's not going to be a lot of HTML code. That's not the server's job. The server's job is simply to provide data back to the client. And the client then does the formatting. Now, the JavaScript, on the other hand, is going to have a lot more work to it. All right? Because it needs to do all these things, and none of these things JavaScript did before, right? None of the examples we had did we have this kind of thing going on. So JavaScript is really going to do a lot more, and our server-side code is going to be very minimal. All right, let me see if I can find the example I was looking for, and we'll go from there. Now, I will go over this a couple of times. So, I mean, I'll go over it today. It'll be your first introduction to it. And next week, we'll revisit either with the same example or a different example. But we'll illustrate these points as well. Because it's important that we have a good understanding of how this works. So, let me look at last year. Okay, let's look at this example. This one will do. Let me show you, first of all, how it works. Page. I type in localhost, which is going to connect to my server. That's another thing to remember with these AJAX things. You have to be using a web server because the web server is involved. Type in localhost. It's going to pull up index.php, right? I didn't supply a name, but remember, when you don't supply a name, you pull up the default page. And this web server is configured to look for index.php as a default page. Whatever Google's homepage is called, you know, you don't type in the name of that page, you just type in the domain, www.google.com. And the web server is configured to deliver that homepage. All right, here's a quiz. All right, and I'm going to type in my answers, 6 and 12. and click grade. Now notice what happened. Happens immediately. We don't see the page refreshing. All right. It happens immediately. All right. So let's see how that gets done. All right. And I use a little bit of PHP to create the quiz, and I use a little bit of PHP to grade the quiz. I wrote this quiz in a way that would make it easily maintained. All right. Because I could have simply created a plain old HTML document that had so many math problems on it, right? The problem with that is that would make it harder to maintain. So what I did is I did a little more realistic thing. I wrote code to produce the quiz and code to grade the quiz. For example, like if you take a quiz in Canvas, there's probably a database that has a list of the questions and a list of the answers. And that is used to generate the HTML for the quiz. Anyhow, let's look at the HTML. The first page, the index page, is a conventional page. In other words, it's initially loaded. All right? It's initially loaded in a traditional manner. In other words, the user asks for the page processes and loads. I have an include for questions. Let's see what's in that include. What's in that include is the numbers for the math problem that I'm doing. If you remember, the first problem was 1 plus 5. The second problem was 8 plus 4. So I have two arrays here. 1 plus 5, 8 plus 4. So if I were to add more things to this, I'd have more questions on my page. But I only have two. All right. Let's add a question here. So let's add 10 plus 20. Let's save that. Whoops. Let me make sure I'm opening them up from the right place, the desktop. All right, so I'm going to add 10 plus 20. I can copy this include to my web server. And then if I hit refresh here, notice I'm going to have 10 plus 20 on the end of my list. Okay? Now, notice I never put what the answer was. Tell me it's wrong in a minute. Ignore that for now. Let me see if I can pretend I'm the computer and figure this out. I don't know why it's doing that. We'll eliminate that from now and we'll come back to that. Let's get rid of this for now. Then we'll come back to that. back to here. We'll go back to where we know it worked. Okay, let's see how the code gets generated for the quiz. I have my answers here. Or rather, I have my list of questions, and my questions are two-part. They're addition. So I have the first number and the second number in that. I have my display form function. My display form function creates a global for addN1, addN2, and error message. What are those? Those are my arrays that are declared in my include file. If I want to use something that's declared outside of a function, I use the global directive. That says, hey, use the variable addN1, addN2, and error message that are declared outside of this function. And those variables are declared right here in the include file. So this allows me, within this function, to access the arrays that are contained in this include file. So what do I do when I display the form? Actually eliminate this. So what am I doing? I'm looping through my array. I'm outputting. This is outputting the question. addN1 plus addN2 equals, I have my text box for it. Notice what I'm naming the text box. I'm naming the text box sub-0. So the first answer is going to be answer 0. The second answer is going to be answer 1, and so on down the line. I believe I can get rid of that too. Those are sort of leftovers from what I had before. Notice this is a button. This is not a submit button. All right. And on click, I call grade quiz. So let's save everything and make sure it still works, because I eliminated a couple lines of code here. So it still works even though I eliminated those. Those were left over. When I did this example in a previous class, I used regular traditional PHP methods. So I can get rid of that code. Now let's look at the HTML that gets generated by this. When I do an initial load. Notice that the first answer is called answer 0. The first error space is called answer 0 error, or answer error 0. The second answer is called answer 1, and the error area is called answer error 1. So I'm doing this in a very organized way. That's going to be useful for me when I write the code to do the processing. The NoScript tag is if they happen to have JavaScript disabled. If they happen to have JavaScript disabled, we could take a couple of methods to deal with that. In this case, we're simply notifying the user that this isn't going to work because they don't have JavaScript enabled. Is that a valid way of dealing with it? Well, that's more of a philosophical question, so I won't talk about that today. Any questions on how the quiz gets generated? In a nutshell, we loop through my array of values. All these are the same kind of problem. They're all addition problems with two numbers. So we take the first number from this array, the first number from this array, and that's the first question. 1 plus 5. The second one is 8 plus 4. Alright, and then we do that for all the numbers down the line. Alright, so now we loop through them. We do for each element in the array. We display the first number plus second number, and then we create a text box that has the name of and the ID of answer and then the number of its position in the array. So in this case, we have answer 0 and answer 1. So this makes our quiz dynamic, so it can be generated. Now, let's get to the AJAX part. And I don't think we'll cover the whole AJAX part today. I will put this example out there, and you can take a look at it, and we'll review it a little bit. We'll review it more on Tuesday. I will at least talk briefly about the three sections of this. The first section, the making the request, the first piece of that is to make what's called a request object. The request object is the pipeline between the client and the server. It's the mechanism by which the client sends data to the server for an XML HTTP request. And it's the mechanism by which the client gets the answer back from the server. And it's the mechanism by which the client gets informed that the server is done with its job. AJAX stands for Asynchronous JavaScript and XML. All right? Asynchronous means that JavaScript doesn't stop operation until it gets an answer back. JavaScript simply waits until it gets informed. It's asynchronous, like voicemail is asynchronous. In other words, if you call someone and leave a voicemail, you don't hang on the line until they get back to you. You can go about your business, and they will notify you when they're getting back to you. In order to do that, you create a request object. Now, this is code, and this is kind of older code, to create a request object. In a nutshell, what this code means is, if you're running an older version of Internet Explorer, this is how you create the request object. If you're running any other browser, this is how you create the request object. It's the same request object, it's just the mechanism for creating it is a little different depending on the browser you're on. So here you create it one way, here you create it another way. In either case, you have a request object. And that request object I'm calling HTTP. Slightly misnamed, I should probably call it XML HTTP, but we'll go with that. So this creates the pipeline. This makes the quiz. And I see what was wrong with it before. I have a variable for the number of questions here. And I didn't update that to 3. So it didn't know to grade that third one. Alright. This is a code that formats and makes a request. The request consists of a URL and GET, which is the same thing that we use when we post a form. We use GET or POST. GET simply means we're passing the data on the query string. So, I create my URL. And we're not going to look at the details of that. Essentially, I loop through the answers and display, add those to the URL. I then make the request to the server. And I give a callback function name. Callback function name is like the return call number when you leave a voicemail message. Oh yeah, when you're ready to get back to me, this is what is going to get called. So this goes to the server. The server does its thing, which is very straightforward. Server loops through the questions, looks at the answers, compares the answer that the user gave with the answer that it gets from actually adding the numbers together, and either outputs a Y or an N, if it matches or not. Remember, anything that says print gets sent back to the client. When this finishes, this function gets called. Why does this function get called? Because that's the callback function. That's the function that we said should get called when the server's done with its thing. And what does a client do? It takes the response from the server and formats it for the client. All right? Takes it and formats the client. All right, I see the problem from this, and the problem from this is I've hard-coded that too. Hard-coding always gets you into trouble. All right? So I could change that to be 3, and then I'd be able to add my third question. But we'll look next time on maybe a better solution to that. And then we'll spend more time examining the AJAX part of it. If this is a little fuzzy, that's okay. Today was just meant to be an overview of the process. Just keep in mind that the server side is pretty straightforward. It's looking at the request, it's returning a series of Y's and N's. The client side is a little more complicated. The client side creates an object to make the request, the pipeline. It actually makes a request of the server. Then it does something with the response once everything is finished. All right? Any questions at this point? Look this over. We'll review it in more detail on Tuesday. All right, we'll see you in lab.